I want to help you get the best night's sleep you've ever had. So I'm trying to optimize my routine to get the best night's sleep I've ever had. Over 3 weeks, I'm going to be trying some wild gadgets in the ultimate experiment to see if I can improve my sleep. Everything from $200 face massaging goggles to a nearly $3,000 sleep promoting sauna. And I'm doing a polysomnography or sleep test to check for sleep disorders.
This looks intense.
I've come to the world's very first sleep clinic at Stanford to meet Dr. Rafael Pelayo, a clinical professor and all-round expert in sleep medicine. I'm hoping he can give me some answers to why so many of us feel like we get bad sleep and what we can do to improve it.
You want to get somebody to sleep better, you got to focus on what the actual issue is. If it turns out that only the amount of hours is the issue, and then you find out what's happening in their lifestyle that's interfering with that. And you may incorporate a nap into their schedule, perhaps, if you could do that. Or if you have an issue with the quality of your sleep, then you got to do a sleep test and see what's going on. So we got to just tease it out.
Okay, if we could distill all of this sleep advice into something that's really actionable that somebody like me can actually implement.
I think you want to focus on waking up, not falling asleep.
Okay.
Because you can force yourself to wake up easier than you can force yourself to fall asleep. Figure out what time you want to wake up. Lock in the wake-up time first. Instead of saying, I wake up depending on when I fell asleep, then you have variable wake-up times, and that throws off the circadian rhythms. You're going to end up spending less time in bed by sleeping more efficiently.
Now, I've been tracking my sleep for years with watches and other wearables, and they've always said I'm getting a decent amount of sleep, and it's pretty good quality. But I still wake up tired.
You do have marks on your forehead.
I know I look silly. Thanks, Andy.
No, you look scientific.
Wow.
This is what it takes to get hooked up to a sleep study. Electrodes are placed around my face and head to detect eye movement, muscle tone, and brain waves. I also have an electrocardiogram on my chest to track heart rate, a pulse oximeter on my finger for blood oxygen, and two movement sensors taped to my legs.
Are you feeling lucky?
Very vulnerable right now.
This is gonna be really fascinating to see what you find out.
I am actually kind of strangely concerned that I now am gonna have a sleep issue.
So I'm gonna start plugging things in, and then all I have left are the flow sensors, and those are gonna go in your nose, okay?
In my nose.
In your nose.
Perfectly normal day at the office, so right? Now that's weird. That sensation is not fun.
This is a little more invasive, and this goes in the nose a little more.
I don't like that. Yeah. Like everything else has been fine, and this one feels like I've got two little fingernails digging into my nostrils.
Yeah.
And now it's time for bed. If you want to see the results from my sleep test, stick around until the end of the video because, let's just say, it was surprising.
Well, that cliffhanger sucks.
Okay, it's time to get my sleep habits in order, implement that advice from Dr. Pelayo, and bring in some sleep tech for good measure. So I'm going to lock in my wake-up time each day, yes, even on weekends, and see how I go. I'm also going to track my sleep throughout this challenge with the Aura Ring Gen 3. I chose it for a couple of reasons. One, because it's comfortable to sleep with, and two, it gives me a sleep score, which is a way to compare any progress I might make week by week.
Night number one of the sleep challenge.
This week is all about setting the foundation for good sleep hygiene, and this routine won't cost you any money. But because I want to include some inexpensive tools into this new routine, I'm also trying two no-tech sleep aids I've heard people swear by, a weighted blanket and a body pillow from Twilla. You can add or remove these pods to change the padding to where you need it the most. One morning I came into my room and I found my dog lying on it, so you know it's comfy. I just wish that the body pillow didn't take up the entire bed, but it definitely did help me get more comfortable during the night. Okay, end of week one, time to do the check-in, see how I'm feeling and what my sleep score is, and the average over 7 nights is 79. Not too bad. I feel like it kind of represents how I'm feeling. Some days I felt super alert when I got up, and other days I honestly just felt like a truck had hit me and I just didn't want to get out of bed.
Welcome to week number two of trying to improve my sleep. This time I'm adding on with the Hatch Restore 2 and the Therabody Smart Goggles. And I'm also gonna do a bit of guided meditation thanks to Chris Hemsworth's Power Sleep in the Center app. Yeah, who doesn't want Thor reading them a bedtime story?
The Hatch Restore 2 is like a little sun on your bedside table. And yes, TikTok made me try it. It simulates sunset and sunrise, and it has sounds to lull you into serenity, wake you up gently, or both if you like. I do like how it subtly reminds me it's bedtime when I walk into my room and I see that gentle glow. And I've heard a lot about the Therabody smart goggles, so of course I had to try them. The idea of a massaging mask with heat sounds great, right? There's even a sleep mode that's supposed to put you into a peaceful state of mind and lower your heart rate.
That's pretty nice. It's Monday morning. I actually woke up feeling kind of good this morning, super alert, and I didn't feel like I needed to kind of kickstart my day with caffeine.
Then of course this week it all came crashing down.
It's 10:30, babe. It's time to sleep.
I feel terrible.
Let's just say I had a rough couple of nights. Fortunately, because I was still sticking to my new wake-up schedule and my body was kind of doing it for me by waking up automatically without an alarm, one or two bad nights' sleep didn't derail me that much. I just felt like a dumpster fire for a few hours.
And this week's average sleep score is 81. Okay, not bad. What I've noticed is that things like my heart rate variability is getting better. My latency, or the time it takes to go to sleep, is getting better. I'm feeling more relaxed, a little bit more alert. Still not as alert as I think I could be.
So cozy and warm in here. This is gonna be a fun week.
This is the Curve, an infrared sauna from Clearlight. Unlike hot rock saunas, this has infrared heating panels that wrap around you, so it doesn't heat up the air, it only heats you. The idea is to take a sauna at night, then have about a 30-minute cool-down period where you can sit and relax, maybe take a shower. And this is when your body temperature should drop and melatonin gets produced, otherwise known as the sleep hormone.
But one piece of pricey sleep tech isn't enough, so I'm going for the double with the 8 Sleep Pod 3. This is kind of like a fancy fitted sheet that fits on top of your existing mattress, and it's a water-based system that heats and cools each side of the bed automatically, and it's supposed to help you sleep better and longer.
Oh, this feels so warm. It's like a hot water bottle. I can't wait to get into bed.
I keep this nice and toasty for most of the night, but if you're the opposite and you run hot, you can set it as low as 55 degrees, so it's kind of almost like turning your whole mattress to the cool side.
On most nights when I took a sauna, I had a shower, and I jumped into bed with 8 Sleep, I got some of my best sleep scores ever. I fell asleep faster when I got into bed, I had fewer wake-ups during the night, and most importantly, I felt refreshed in the morning. Because we're keeping track, my average sleep score this week is 83. So I do feel like I'm sleeping better with my expensive toys. That's in part to really solidifying my routine and staying consistent with my wake-up time. But how much comes down to placebo? Dr. Pelayo says it's probably more than I think.
If you trust it, it'll have a very strong placebo effect.
Yeah?
We know this from sleeping pill studies. There's about a 30% response just from getting the placebo.
Well, the sleep score doesn't lie. Or does it? Confusingly, some of the nights where I felt like I slept the best during this entire experiment, I had a pretty low sleep score. So it's really important to know that sleep trackers are just tools and helpful for seeing trends over time. And don't forget, any sleep score is proprietary. Every fitness tracker, smart ring, and smart watch use different algorithms to come up with that number. They can't detect or diagnose sleep disorders like a sleep test can, at least not yet, which brings us back to the polysomnography. I wake up and Dr. Pelayo shows me my results.
Oh, hi. Good morning.
You're really pretty sleep architecture. You're supposed to have the bulk of the REM at the last half of the night, last third.
The eye movement, that's typical rapid eye movement.
So you're completely within specs for that sleep architecture.
It's very, very normal sleep.
No, it's not.
No. Uh-oh.
You had 28 times you had shallow breathing that interrupted your sleep.
No air. See, no air is moving.
So because it's flat.
Yeah.
Nothing going in.
So you had 3.3 breathing episodes per hour. We call sleep apnea starting at 5 events an hour.
Okay.
So as you get older, it may become an issue for you. But the main abnormal finding I'm explaining what's going on is your legs are kicking.
You have an arousal right there.
Oh, yeah.
And see, look, see, this is all it is. Look
at it's just it's a tiny twitch, though.
136 times you kicked your legs last night.
No one there. Both legs now.
Just for perspective, that's 16.2 events per hour on your leg movements. Abnormal is 15 per hour. But it makes sense. You're feeling tired, something physically wrong with your sleep. But you saw that your sleep tracker said you're doing great. But when you drill down in an actual sleep study, you can see how you see other things that the tracker's not picking up on.
But now I have all this information. What do I do with it?
Talk to your physician.
I have to talk to my doctor about it.
Even a week after we filmed that, I'm still kind of in shock. I honestly thought my sleep was okay, and I was just feeling tired because I became a mom, but it turns out there was a whole lot more going on with my sleep that I would never have known if I didn't do this story. Now, one super important thing to remember, this video is not medical advice. If you have sleep concerns, please, please, please talk to your doctor or healthcare provider. Most of the sleep tech I tested helped me feel better, and some even helped me sleep better, but it didn't fix the underlying issue we found on the sleep study. But everybody sleeps differently, and I hope something in this video can help you. The ultimate irony though, I've actually had some of the worst night's sleep while writing this story after I finished filming the experiment. So please click like and subscribe to make it all worth it. A huge thank you to the Stanford Sleep Medicine Center and Dr. Pelayo for explaining what we can do to all improve our sleep and for diagnosing me with a sleep condition I didn't know I had, and to the Four Seasons Hotel San Francisco at Embarcadero for this beautiful, beautiful suite. Sweet dreams, and thank you for watching.